Okay, so it's now 2:30, because I have a ton of materials to cover today, and I probably won't have enough time to cover them all, so I'd better start on a dot, right? Some of the clips that I ideally would like to show in today's lecture, I'll probably be skipping most of them as well because of the time constraint. I mean, ideally I probably need like 3 or 4 hours to cover everything that I want to cover today, but that's not possible. So they're all available on Moodle. I've already uploaded all of the clips that, you know, those that I will play and those that I won't play, they're all on Moodle. So in case you're interested, you could refer back to them on Moodle after the lecture, if you so wish. So this is today's lecture by me, yours truly, Wong Kar-wai, and the cinematic. There should be a "the" there. Maybe I missed the the cinematic time travel in Hong Kong. I'll try to make sense of what the second bit is towards the end of today's lecture. But I guess I'll start by sharing a little coincidence that I stumbled upon the last time I delivered this lecture in October last year. I received an email from Bloomsbury, the publisher. It was one of their promotional emails that advertised the recently published books. And the book in question is this one that you can see on the screen, hopefully. Can you all see my screen, by the way, in your screen? And you'll see the screen, An Introduction to Film Analysis. okay, yeah, thank you. Wow, there are, yeah, thumbs up. Yeah, thumbs up from Gina, as always. Thank you, Gina. So look at the book cover, right? Does it remind you of anything? Assuming that you have seen this week's assigned film, you have, you know, immediately recognized that this image comes from the film 2046. So if you think about it, out of all the films out there across the entire history of cinema, from like the Lumiere brothers or to Chaplin to Hitchcock or whoever, they've gone with an image from 2046 for their book. So naturally, I was curious. I went to their website to check out the actual book, and looking at the contents page, you'll find that, first of all, a list of useful topics for perhaps you to do film analysis or, you know, whatever during a video test or, you know, presentation, what have you. This isn't an advert to persuade you to buy the book, by the way. If anything, it's the exact opposite, as you'll see. If you look at the bottom of the contents page, you'll find, first of all, presumably this is the part where the book puts its theory into practice with what they call the sample analysis, right? But then you'll find the front cover is a bit of a false advertisement, because instead of 2046, their analysis is actually On In The Mood For Love instead. Obviously, both were directed by Wong Kar-wai, but, you know, they are decidedly, categorically and catastrophically even, not the same film. So what's going on there? Right. I can't give you a straight answer right now, except to point you to something else that's also worth your attention, I think. So this was a poll that the BBC did in 2016, asking film critics around the world to vote for what they thought were the greatest films in the 21st century. So out of all the films made after the year 2000, up until 2016, obviously that was when the poll was made, film experts, quote-unquote film experts, usually the film critics, people like that, thought that Wong Kar-wai's In the Mood for Love was the second best film, not the first, not quite the first, but second. I think second is high enough if you think about it. In fact, in many other similar types of you know, this sort of greatest of all time or greatest of the century type polls, In the Mood for Love almost always appears, and at very high ranks as well. So as you can see, Wong Kar-wai is truly a world-class filmmaker, if not one of the best filmmakers in the world. If your idea of best or good aligns with what these film critics believe, because you may argue that judgment on artistic merits can be a very subjective thing. Meanwhile, in case you're wondering, 2046 is nowhere to be seen on this poll or any other poll. In fact, I can guarantee you that 2046 wouldn't appear in most people's sort of Wong Kar-wai's top three list, that sort of thing. It's most certainly isn't in my top three. If you've been following the Spock materials, and if you've been clever enough, you'd be able to deduce that in most iterations of our 9001 course, we'd normally have Gina delivering a lecture based around In the Mood for Love, again, instead of 2046. But don't worry, if you want Gina's version of Wong Kar-wai, you can always access the Spock, which is available on Moodle. And incidentally, I've also uploaded In the Mood for Love onto Moodle as a recommended viewing in case you'd like to watch the better film, as it were, if you're interested or want to be better equipped to understand Wong Kar-wai. Even though technically you won't be tested on it during video test 2, I still highly recommend you to go watch In the Mood for Love to get a better understanding, or just generally enjoy good cinema, really, because it, you know, In the Mood for Love is really good. So what's the deal with me assigning 2046 instead of the better film, right? In case you haven't worked it out, 2046 is actually a sequel to In the Mood for Love, right? 4 years after In the Mood for Love in 2004. And naturally, you'd think that you'd have to watch episode 1 in order to understand episode 2. But that's not quite the case, at least according to Wong Kar-wai himself. This is an interview with Wong Kar-wai. I'm not going to play the clip because it's kind of long and he talks kind of slow. But in this interview, Wong Kar-wai explains the nature of 2046 being the sequel to In the Mood for Love. And in particular, he made this comment saying, and this is near the bottom of my slide here, if the audience haven't seen In the Mood for Love before, they should watch 2046 first. Blah, blah, blah. It's like the missing chapter of this novel, the novel being In the Mood for Love, obviously. So for those of you who saw In the Mood for Love first before 2046, myself included, we are doing it wrong. But all jokes aside, and like I always say, for those of you who know me, who are in my classes, I always repeat this, there is no right or wrong. And it's certainly very true in today's context, as you see later in the lecture, or throughout the lecture. In today's lecture, we'll be addressing, you know, these following issues. First of all, we'll be addressing the issue of through a global lens, which is the second half of the 9001 equation, if you will, Hong Kong cinema through a global lens, right? We'll be looking at who Wong Kar-wai is. He's an auteur. We'll surely be looking at this term, auteur, in more detail later on. We'll also be briefly looking at most of his other films to get a sense of what kind of filmmaker he is, using two approaches, which I'll explain in detail later, obviously. One is what I'd call a culturalist approach, which looks at film as something else, as I put it on the slide there, looking at film as something else, as a cultural product that reflects socio-political issues, you know, that sort of thing. This, incidentally, is the approach that you should all be familiar with by now, judging by how many of you have gone to town, essentially, with your video test essays talking about The Handover, right, in City of Glass, right? That would be a sort of a culturalist approach to reading that film. The second approach is sort of obvious if you think about it. It's a more obvious way, which is why I even put duh, right, on the slide, because it's so obvious. Imagine looking at City of Glass, you know, having ignored the whole sort of China, Hong Kong, Britain relationship altogether, then you may have a rough idea of, or not, of how this other approach goes, right? And there is a third mysterious approach, which, to be brutally honest, may not be that relevant to 9001, but the hope is that at least it demonstrates what kind of creative paths you can take when you attempt to make new scholarship, or you know, new perspectives, if you will. I probably should switch that off. Bear with me for a second, yes. Back to Wong Kar-wai. This is him, right? These are the images. These images represent the sort of typical image of Wong Kar-wai, the glamorous, always on the red carpet, attending film festivals, always in his trademark sunglasses, you know, all those kind of things. And if you are wondering about global connection, which is something that some of you struggle with, I'm told, look no further. Wong Kar-wai himself is the global connection, with a bunch of emojis at the end, because it's a bit of tongue-in-cheek, because that doesn't really explain anything by saying Wong Kar-wai is the global connection himself. So I should really elaborate. He is a transnational filmmaker, you could say, By transnational, we don't mean just the conventional definition of transcending national borders or what have you. Wong Kar-wai's transnationalism is in a slightly different sort of sense, right? He definitely brings Hong Kong cinema to the global stage, especially in art cinema, in the film festival circuit. But he does this by being neither locally Hong Kong nor belonging to any established Western, quote-unquote Western, film tradition. Stephen Teo perhaps explains this a lot better than I do. I understand this is a very long quote, and there's a page two to this quote as well, but I think we need to sort of go through it to understand sort of the nuances. So I'll read this out for you. Wong Kar-wai is one of a handful of Hong Kong Chinese directors whose name is readily recognized in the West, without having to adopt a Western first name like John Woo, Bruce Lee, both of whom we looked at in 9001, incidentally. Wong Kar-wai has come to signify cool, postmodern sensibility in world cinema. However, as a Chinese name that is moreover rendered in Cantonese phonetics, Wong Kar-wai sounds exotic, foreshadowing a highly local sensibility rather than a global phenomenon. But then, later on in the book, on page 160 to 161, he kind of puts forward a slightly different, almost contradictory sort of point of view. So he says, Wong Kar-wai's films are the creative and instinctive response of an artist brought up in a Hong Kong environment that has always fashioned his own unique interpretation of film art and culture, making something new out of a patchwork quilt of Eastern and Western elements and a crossing of many genres. Just like Hong Kong itself, Wong's films constitute a cornucopia overflowing with multiple stories, strands of expressions, meanings and identities. A kaleidoscope of colors and identities. It is taken for granted that Wong's films provide a substitute to the crass commercial fare of most Hong Kong cinema and to the Hollywood blockbusters that dominate the cinemas of the world. But they also give us alternative ways of looking at art cinema. Wong cinema may be defined as asymmetric art in a way that makes it distinctive in both Eastern and Western context. It is much too romantic, much too emotional, and ultimately much too Hong Kong to be located in the same topography of European-style high art cinema. And I feel this should be a but here, let's just say but. But it is much too cool, much too genteel, and ultimately much too otherworldly to be simply recognized as Hong Kong. So a bit of note on that, highlighted phrase there, crass commercial fare of most Hong Kong cinema. I mean, it's a bit harsh, right? It's a bit harsh on the state of Hong Kong cinema, but you can sort of see where he's coming from, as you should be familiar by now. Hong Kong cinema before Wong Kar-wai was mostly operating in the action genre, sort of fast-paced, action-packed films. They may be seen as the opposite of art cinema, where things are more slow-paced and leaving room for you to do cinematic contemplation or any sort of all that sort of artsy stuff that you can think of, right? I mean, if you think about it, we've covered Jackie Chan, Bruce Lee, or even John Woo. They're all sort of more towards the action genre, right? If you recall the BBC poll I showed you earlier, people like David Lynch, Michael Haneker, Terrence Malick, all those people definitely belong to the latter category of the artsy filmmakers, right? But then Teo here is saying that Wong Kar-wai belongs to neither one of these camps, or more precisely, he is sort of in between these two camps. Right? More importantly, he thinks that Wong Kar-wai represents a paradox that is neither local nor global, right? At the end of this quote here, that you can see him comment that Wong is too unlike Hong Kong to be Hong Kong, right? But then at the same time, he is too Hong Kong to be in the sort of conventional art cinema category that is, you might argue, is Eurocentric. If you look at the cast and crew of 2046, you see people from many countries and regions in Asia. So it's an Asian film, no doubt, definitely. But is it quintessentially a Hong Kong film? Some may argue that it's not, while others may agree that precisely because of its diverse nature, it makes it quintessentially Hong Kong, or the paradoxical nature of it, as Stephen Teo would put it, right? Again, like I always say, there's no right or wrong. Meanwhile, if you look at the sort of the financing bodies here, you see money coming from many countries. You have France, you have Italy, I think that's Germany, and I think China as well. Definitely fits the finance scapes of Arjuna Padurai, who we looked at during week one, right? If you recall, if you still recall that person. Padurai proposes the five scapes to explore what he calls disjunctures in the process of globalization. And these disjunctures are, as I understand it, these disjunctures mean the tension between cultural homogenization and heterogenization, right? So one is making things uniform, homogenization, and then the other is making things more diverse, heterogenization, right? And the five scapes are dimensions of what he calls global cultural flow. Think about Wong Kar-wai and his own brand of art cinema, how he's bringing Hong Kong cinema, or the lack of it, because you might say Wong Kar-wai cinema is not very Hong Kong, to the globe. Later on, when we use this idea of the auteur to describe Wong Kar-wai, to imply that Wong Kar-wai cinema may be read as his own individual take, rather than the collective vision of Hong Kong cinema as a whole, it kind of goes against this whole idea of the global cultural flow, right, with Wong Kar-wai cinema, or as I put it just now, the lack of Hong Kong cinema, right? These are the two opposite sides of this very same argument, or to put it another way, again, for the 100th time, there is no right or wrong. Meanwhile, towards the end of this Padurai quote, I'm highlighting this phrase, multiple worlds, here for a very specific reason. Of course, here Padurai is referring to the diverse nature of global cultures, hence calling it multiple worlds, right? You have diversity, of course, multiple things, right? But then at the end of this lecture, hopefully we have enough time to get to that part. You see that this phrase can take on a very different meaning if you put a different spin. So with that in mind, we move on. I already mentioned these 2+1 approaches that we'll be using today. I'll be alternating between these two approaches to read Wong Kar-wai. One is what Gary Bettinson, who's reading, incidentally, is on Moodle. It's one of your assigned reading. Calls it the culturalist approach, as I said before. The other approach, looking at film as a film, you know, remember, kind of, duh, is what I like to call the aesthetic approach, or, you know, Gary Bettinson calls it poetics, but I think it, you know, as for symmetry purposes, I just call it aesthetic approach as opposed to culturalist approach, right? So that, you know, there's in this approach, there's no beyond, right? The film is just the film. There's no beyond. There's no hidden message. That it's just an artistic expression, right? Film is just a beautiful object, as it were. The culturalist approach is somewhat the opposite. If you think about it, it's somewhat the opposite approach to the aesthetic approach, where there is always a correlation, a hidden correlation between the film and its underlying sociopolitical backdrop or what have you. Case in point would be the City of Glass example that I just mentioned, as well as Infernal Affairs, if you still recall from last week. You know, Infernal Affairs is about two people from opposite sides infiltrating each other's camps as moles. And if you follow the culturalist approach, then you'll see that it's a political allegory, you know, on the identity crisis that Hong Kong is experiencing. But if you really think about it, do you really have to go that far? You know, maybe it's a personal preference sort of thing. I know Gina likes this sort of analysis a lot, and I do. I like this sort of analysis as well. It's very clever and all that. But if you think about it, you don't necessarily have to go that far. You can simply stop at the level where it's just, you know, an exciting story about double-crossing, you know, exciting, good acting, maybe handsome actors, what have you. Just stop at that level and then, you know, move on. Just look at it as an aesthetic object. So that's another approach. These two approaches are equally valid as well as interesting. Again, like for the 1,000th time now, there is no right or wrong way to look at a film. That's my main point, I guess. By the end of the lecture, I will be throwing this third mysterious, maybe not so mysterious by now, third approach, which is somewhat unique to me, you can say, to understand cinema, using the concept of time travel. This third concept, I hope, at least would, you know, sort of give you a glimpse of how you can come up with your own position using the tools that you already have, right? As a critical person, as a thinking person, right? So back to the films, In the Mood for Love and 2046, there is actually another film that completes a sort of informal trilogy. Days of Being Wild from 1990, all three films, Days of Being Wild from 1990, In the Mood for Love from 2000, and then 2046 from 2004. These three films, they all share one common thread, which is the character played by Maggie Cheung, as you can see on the poster here, right? Here you see Maggie Cheung, here you see Maggie Cheung. Whereas here you kind of, I don't know which one is Maggie Cheung, probably can't see her. That's sort of the whole point of the film. So in 2046, you see a different Su Li Jun, but Maggie Cheung plays Su Li Jun, the character Su Li Jun in all three films, even in 2046. But you see a different Su Li Jun in 2046, right? Played by Gong Li. Maggie Cheung's Su Li Jun, as Wong Kar-wai mentions in the interview, which I'm sort of regretting not playing this now, but in that interview, you can always check back on Moodle. In that interview, Wong Kar-wai mentions that she's just merely an image or a representation of sort of an ideal figure, right? So she's not really a character. Towards the end of the film, you see Chow, Tony Leung's character, discussing his encounter with the describing his encounter with the original, the OG Su Li Jun, with this new Su Li Jun, right, played by Gong Li. So for those of you who, he's discussing his past encounter with the OG Su Li Jun. So for those of you who have seen In the Mood for Love, of course, you know exactly what he's talking about. You know, this scene, this iconic scene here, them sitting in the back of the taxi. But for those of you who haven't, it will be like the central idea, I would argue. It's like a central idea of 2046 itself. If you recall, at the very beginning of the film, the voiceover says this: In 2046, a vast rail network spans the globe. A mysterious train leaves for 2046, the place. Every once in a while, everyone going to 2046 has only one intention: to recapture their lost memories. Right. So if you think about it, In the Mood for Love, for those of you who haven't seen In the Mood for Love, kind of is the lost memories, because you didn't have it in the first place. Right, so it's sort of the lost memories, or as Wong Kar-wai himself mentions in that interview, which I didn't play, regretting it hugely right now, like the missing chapter, right? He calls it the missing chapter. It's sort of like the same idea as this lost memory. That is sort of the central idea of 2046. I probably won't regret not playing this, but I prepared this clip from this sort of classic scene from In the Mood for Love, to sort of show you the relationship between the old Su Li Jun and Mr. Chow, Tony Leung's character. We probably don't have time to play because it's kind of long, but it's a very juicy, I would call it a juicy clip. It's the clip where they're in the restaurant and the Maggie's like, no, Tony is like, oh, your handbag looks pretty, where did you get it? And then Maggie is like, oh, your tie looks very dashing, where did you get it? And then the discussion goes on to, and then it leads to something else. They discover that their respective spouses have cheated on them. So that's the slow discovery, the slow realization of that. Just great. But instead of that clip, I'm actually going to show you this one from Days of Being Wild, because I think this is even more important than the previous one. So this is the first appearance of Su Li Jun. So let's play this. Hopefully there's sound. This is the start of the film, by the way. I think that's too loud.
What's your name? 我知你叫咩名，应该叫做苏丽珍。边个话俾你知噶？
今晚發佈會見到我。
Let's just skip over this because it kind of gets long. So. The opening title, obviously. Yeah, the scene within this carry on. I believe it's the next day.
有啲唔同喎，冇啊，有咩唔同啊？冇，你耳仔唔紅嘅，
你究竟想點啫？冇，
想同你做朋友啫。
我點解同你做朋友啊？
睇下我嘅表，
點解睇住你表啫？
一分鐘啊！
夠鐘啦，講啦。今日幾多號？16號咯。16，4月16。1960年4月16號下晝3點之前嘅一分鐘，你同佢埋一齊，因為你我會記得嗰一分鐘。由而家開始，我哋就一分鐘嘅朋友。呢個係事實嚟嘅，你追唔翻。
因為已經過去咗，我聽會咗你。佢有冇因為我而記得嗰分鐘？我唔知，但我一直都記住呢個人。後屘佢真係日日都嚟，我哋就係一分鐘嘅朋友。
Right, so yeah, before I actually make any sort of comment or even stupid jokes on the clip, I usually do that. I'd like to bring your attention to something else first while you marinate on that clip that you just saw. Bring your attention to a recent development of this informal trilogy. This was what happened in early 2019, I believe. Yeah, 2019. Wong Kar-wai announced his next project would be called Blossoms, based on a novel of the same name. Blossoms was meant to be a film which would follow the series, so following 2046, right? So it's kind of like a sequel to 2046, which is a sequel to In the Mood for Love, so you know, that's a series. But then, of course, COVID-19 hit, and then everything got either delayed or cancelled. Blossoms has now become Blossom Shanghai, and it would be a TV series rather than a film. Wong was also working on another TV series called Tong Wars, chronicling the gang rivalries in turn of the century San Francisco Chinatown. That was simply cancelled, as I pointed out here by the big red arrow there. It's just, the show is now dead, right? This, incidentally, wasn't the first time a Wong Kar-wai project failed to become reality. When Wong Kar-wai finished 2046, he was actually all excited about this upcoming project, or so he called it. His upcoming project called Lady from Shanghai, not to be confused with the Orson Welles film, which also had this very same name, but entirely different thing. So at that time, he secured Nicole Kidman to play the lead role. I believe it also went into like full pre-production stages. They even made this mock poster, right? I mean, come on, this one you're seeing on the screen to promote the whole thing. But Wong Kar-wai's extremely slow working schedule, which we will talk about later, with that that clashes with Nicole Kidman's very busy scheduling conflicts and stuff, and other reasons as well. That all of that meant that this project fell through in the end. It will probably never become a reality. Anyway, so all of that's just a side note. Back to the clip you just saw, right? What else besides Su Lijin, like the first appearance of Su Lijin, did you notice? Obviously, because we are running out of time, so I'm just gonna simply tell you what I have noticed. Right, it's the medium close-ups of the clocks. Of course, the clock isn't just a prop. It, if you get it, then it's also symbolizes the passing of time. Right, this this line on 16th of April 1960, during that 1 minute before 3 o'clock we were together, and then we spend this 1 minute together. This is a fact, you cannot deny it, because it's already happened. So this is somewhat of a pickup line delivered by Leslie Jung's character Yadi. It illustrates how Wong Kar-wai and his cinema sort of think of time, right? But besides being just a questionable pickup line, it also reminds us of the irreversibility of time. The one single minute that they spend together, right, is gone. It's forever gone. You can't turn back time to change the fact that they were together. They were technically together for that 1 minute, right? So images of clocks are plenty throughout Wong Kar-wai's body of work. Here you can see some examples. This one's from Fallen Angels. This one's In the Mood for Love. This one's Happy Together. In 2046, I don't really recall any images of clocks or timekeeping devices, but perhaps that would be a fun challenge for you to sort of look for images of clocks or allusion to sort of the nature of time in 2046. But here I'm leaving you with a few of the film's lines that show how Wong Kar-wai's cinema deals with the notion of time. So moving on, a bit of biographical information on Wong Kar-wai. He was born in 1958 in Shanghai, only moved to Hong Kong with his parents at the age of five. In one of the readings that I assigned, it mentioned that Wong Kar-wai was the middle child of three, and only he got to move to Hong Kong, essentially leaving the other two behind. The reading didn't really mention like any reason for that, nor any sort of ramification such a separation had brought to both the left behind, the other two, and the moved on, Wong Kar-wai himself. It may be an interesting area to do further research, especially if you want to go down that sort of culturalist approach of linking his autobiographical background to what was simultaneously happening elsewhere, like around him historically. of course, the 60s was when the entirety of that Su Lijian trilogy, or whatever you want to call it, was set in. The fact that there was a strong association with the Shanghainese community in Hong Kong at the time, those moves, especially in the Mood for Love, not so much 2046, but definitely in the Mood for Love. You know, it is only natural that some people find it fruitful to draw comparison between, you know, between the two, you know, reality and fiction, sort of. And also throwing in other landmark historical events here on the slide, such as the Great Leap Forward in China, the Cultural Revolution, the 1967 riots in Hong Kong, which incidentally was the watershed moment that separates the events that happen in the Mood for Love and those that happen in 2046. So in the Mood for Love happened before the 1967 riot, and then the events in 2046 happen after the riot, right? So there's a very distinctive sort of sense of that historical event being the watershed without it being very explicitly mentioned. Yeah, that's kind of important as well, for me at least. And if you consider all of these, right, these historical events that happen sort of around him, forming his autobiographical background, right, one would have a very neat platform to do a sort of culturalist reading of Wong Kar-wai's cinema. And then, you know, you have the film title itself, 2046. It's just the last straw. I mean, you know, 2046 being the future historical significance, historically significant year of Hong Kong, right? The end of the 50-year unchanged promise. It's a point that we'll come back to later. He had a cinephilic mother, a cinephile, meaning somebody who loves cinema. I hope everyone in the class is a cinephile. So from a very young age, his mother would take little Kar-wai to cinema to watch films. You may even say that it was then that started cultivating his love and taste of cinema. And then he grew up and he studied graphic design at the Hong Kong Polytechnic and graduated in 1980. After graduation, he then was employed by TVB, one of the largest, if not the largest TV station in Hong Kong, as a trainee scriptwriter. It was also during that time that he met Jeffrey Lau, someone who has helped his career massively. We'll talk about Jeffrey Lau in a bit in, I think, the next slide or two. So after writing some acclaimed screenplays for TV, right, he moved up the ranks and started working in film. It was pretty much the pattern back in the day, especially in Hong Kong cinema, where you have people first starting in TV and then sort of moving slowly up to working in film. People like Toi Hark and An Hui were great examples of this, you know, kind of forming the Hong Kong New Wave, and Wong Kar-wai being the second New Wave. Of course, nowadays TV is very much a declining medium. Everything is now online. You know, you have Netflix and Netflix Originals and all of that. And, you know, so the sort of hierarchy, like TV first and then film, you know, that sort of hierarchy, you may say it's no longer there. Not to mention TVB's popularity has gone down the drain in recent years due to various reasons, which I'm not going to talk about here. You know, new filmmakers nowadays, they just start, you know, doing in small independent projects and all sorts of things before they, you know, they break into film. So TV is no longer the way in, you could say. But anyway, this was back in the late 80s. So in 1987. Wong wrote the screenplay for Patrick Tam's Final Victory and was critically acclaimed. Incidentally, Patrick Tam, like Toi Hark and An Hui, was part of the Hong Kong New Wave. Well, you know, Wong Kar-wai is the second, as I said. Wong Kar-wai is sort of the mentee of Patrick Tam, right? So after Final Victory, he quickly got the chance to direct his own feature film for the first time, which was this one. As Tears Go By, which stars Andy Lau as a small-time gangster, and Maggie Cheung, again, plays his love interest. The film was packaged sort of like a gangster action flick, you know, very much in line with what was popular at the time. If you remember, John Woo's A Better Tomorrow, The Killer, all those films were made around about that time as well. So it was a huge success, right, riding on that trend. Of course, looking at the film now, if you have a chance to look at it, you will immediately notice how much of Wong Kar-wai's trademarks are sort of oozing out of the film, so it was anything but conventional, you know, sort of gangster cinema or what have you. But apparently audience back then didn't really realize it. The second time though, Wong Kar-wai wasn't so lucky, because the audience then felt that his films were just too artsy, hence not enjoyable, right? His second film being Days of Being Wild, the one you just saw, you know, the opening of which you just saw. So Days of Being Wild, despite being a critical success, it's a pretty good film. It was a commercial bomb, because people could, you know, the audience back then sort of saw past Wong Kar-wai, and you know, they thought it was too artsy, not really to their taste, right? Since then, investors started to become afraid of investing in the next Wong Kar-wai project, because they weren't even sure if they could make their investment back, right? But right after Days of Being Wild, Wong wanted to make this epic of a film, a wuxia inflected film, what would become Ashes of Time. But apparently nobody wanted to produce his film at the time, because they were afraid, you know, they were afraid of losing money. So his friend Jeffrey Lau and himself hatched a plan. They would start a film production company together called Jet Tone Company, because apparently that way you could get funding sort of easier. I don't know. So Ashes of Time was Jet Tone's first project, right? It ended up having a massive budget, and even so, Wong wasn't able to finish the film on time. He just kept on, you know, delaying, maybe procrastinating, we don't know. He kept on working and tinkering, and you know, he just couldn't finish it, right? So people who funded the project needed to see the results quick, right? You know, or they would just pull out their investments. I think they were threatening to pull out the investment. So what happened then? Jeffrey Lau came to the rescue again. Lau is mostly associated with the Mole Tao comedy. Mole Tao, loosely translated as farce or, you know, nonsensical humor. Stephen Chow is probably the poster boy of Mole Tao, at least in the early days, when he was just the actor and not the director. In any case, something we will revisit in an upcoming lecture, Fiona's lecture. You might be thrilled to know we'll be talking about Stephen Chow. So at Jet Tone, Lau would make these sort of Mole Tao farcical commercial hits, because people like comedy, right? He would make these hits while Wong would just make his, you know, slowly make his artsy, self-indulgent commercial bombs, right? Lau's profits would offset Wong's deficit. The classic case in point would be this pair of films. If you can read the Chinese titles, you'll notice that the one on the right, the one on the right is definitely referencing, if not downright mocking, the one on the left. The Ego Shooting Heroes was made purely because Wong Kar-wai needed more time and money to finish making Ashes of Time. So Jeffrey Lau hatched this ingenious plan, right? He used the same source material, because they were both based on loosely based on Jin Yong's novel, Eagle Shooting Heroes, obviously. He used pretty much the same cast and crew, he used the same set, he used the same props, the same everything, because Wong was already using them, or rather not using them, you know what I mean? So might as well use them, might as well make the best use of them. So basically, the one on the right, Jeffrey Lau's film, was a recycled version of the one on the left, with an added dose of that sort of Jeffrey Lau's own brand of farcical comedy. It took him only 27 days to finish that film, Jeffrey Lau, and it was a huge success at the box office, because, like I said, people like comedy. People still like it nowadays. And there's no right or wrong. I mean, comedy can be great cinema. I'm not making a judgment here. But, you know, Jeffrey Lau's film made back all the money that Wong Kar-wai had lost at the time, and then some. So that money was poured back in to Wong to keep on working, or not working, on the unfinishable project. For another 18 months, right? You know, can you believe the guy? To give you an idea of how funny this pair of films look side by side, here are some screenshots of our main man, Tony Leung, he's not the protagonist in Ashes, but I think he still played a big part in the film. He was in his usual moody, handsome self, you know, looking slightly off-centered, you know, all cool-like. And then here's the farcical version from Jeffrey Lau, being stung by a bunch of venomous bees, making his whole face swollen. I believe it creates a sort of visual gag. I believe it became sort of an internet meme recently, like his face with the big ears and the thick lips and all that. Meanwhile, during those 18 months, even Wong Kar-wai thought he was caught in a bit of a dead end. He knew he wasn't going anywhere with his big project, big wuxia epic of a film, Ashes of Time. So he needed some kind of a pressure release. So what did he do? He started this side project called Chungking Express, right? Which was just the most un-Wong Kar-wai film you could think of. It was modern, it was fast-paced, and most importantly, it only took him 2 months to finish this project. In fact, it finished before. He finished it before Ashes of Time was released in September 1994, because this was July 1994. He released it, so 2 months before Ashes of Time. Now, Quentin Tarantino, who some of you may be familiar with, may even be fans of, or perhaps you were once a fan, but then after the whole Once Upon a Time in Hollywood fiasco, or the fact that he hasn't really made any decent films since Pulp Fiction, you know, you don't like him anymore, it doesn't matter. But he had a lot to say about Wong Kar-wai, and you can find this, you can find that in this little YouTube video that I've also posted on Moodle. I don't think we have enough time to play this, but it's sort of fun to watch this. Tarantino himself was largely responsible for bringing Wong Kar-wai to the American market, because before then he was little known outside of Hong Kong, outside of the art, cinema, film festival circuit. But after Chungking Express, which he sort of brought to the international market, his popularity, Wong's popularity in the art cinema scene, and sort of verging towards commercial cinema, because more and more people started to hear his name, his popularity just shot through the roof, right? It's a fun video to watch, especially if I would recommend looking out for look out for how someone like Tarantino, who is so deep in quote unquote Western filmmaking tradition, just tries to compare absolutely everything in Wong Kar-wai cinema, and also the whole Asian cinema scene, to their Hollywood / European counterpart. And you may also note that he comments on sort of what Stephen Teo calls the crass nature of Hong Kong cinema. He mentioned something about that as well. He also mentions a possible French New Wave influence, which we will likely touch on later when we talk about the auteur. Right, so 3 years after that, there was actually another film, but we're not going to talk about it, Fallen Angels. I don't think that's a... Well, for me at least, that wasn't a significant film. This is a significant film, right? In 1997, Wong Kar-wai made Happy Together. It was arguably his highest point as a director, because he won Best Director at the Cannes Film Festival. If you're into art cinema or alternative cinema or whatever, you know, it's just way cooler than winning Oscars, right? Which is just an American thing. Of course, you may also argue that Cannes is just a French thing, and you know, not at all a truly global or borderless, you know, cinematic representation or what have you. A totally separate discussion. But now I have a clip from Happy Together that I really, 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 really want to show you. It's very, very, very long, but I think it's significant, especially if you want to see how the sort of tension between the culturalist approach to read a film and the aesthetic approach, right? They can be pitted against each other or coexist with one another. Before I play that clip, let me start by explaining a bit of background here, because it's kind of difficult to explain if you haven't seen the film. So Happy Together is about a gay couple played by Leslie Cheung and Tony Leung, again from Hong Kong. Somehow they travel to Argentina long term. The reason for them being in Argentina is never really explicitly mentioned, but since the start of the film, they've both sort of share this dream, this ambition of visiting this breathtaking waterfall called the Iguazu Falls. And due to one thing or another, you know, somehow they never managed to go there. As a couple, they have a turbulent relationship, and they've basically been constantly on and off, that sort of thing. But they always end up making up, and you know, be on again, right? So the on and off, and then on again. Except for this one time near the end of the film, Tony Leung's character Fei decides to end things once and for all, and then move on. And Leslie Cheung's character, on the other hand, appears to not really want to move on. So let me play this. So enjoy. It's a very long clip. That's the end of it, but let me just start from here. Yeah. So this is a lamp, right? This is a lamp that has a picture of the Iguazu Falls in question. They bought this lamp sort of as a future memorabilia, sort of, you know, commemorating their trip, right? The success, the success in making that trip without having made that trip at all. So it's sort of like a future celebration. Sort of an irony. You see two people there. I mean, this music is so fire, but I regret to say that I need to give you a bit more explanation because the scene coming up needs explanation. So, you know, let's just turn it down. Still listen to this fire while I explain some detail, right? So there is actually a third character, right? Besides Tony Leung's character and Leslie Cheung's character, there is this third character played by a Taiwanese actor, Chang Chen, who, in case you haven't noticed or have noticed, also appears very, very briefly in 2046 as Lulu's jealous stabby boyfriend, if you remember, early on in 2046. So he, Chang Chen here in Happy Together, he plays someone who Fei, Tony Leung's character, meets after the breakup, right, with Leslie Cheung's character. It's never explicitly suggested whether Chang is also gay or whether Chang knows that Tony Leung's character is gay. The on-screen relationship is just that they are purely friends. Similar to this Iguazu Falls thing, right? This ambition of, you know, needing to go there, right? Chang also has a dream of his own, which is to go to this place called the End of the World, which also in Argentina, where it's supposed to be the most southerly point on the globe, apart from the South Pole, obviously. Let me just skip that. So Chang, his third character, actually makes it to the end of the world.
I'm going to go to the end of the world. 可能是錄音機壞了。什麼聲音都沒有。只有兩下很奇怪的聲音。好像一個人在哭。Right,
so I feel like I need to explain that as well. The previous night of him making this trip, he promised Tony Leung's character he would bring the tape. So he gives him a tape to record a secret message. So Chang asked Tony Leung's character to record a secret message, to record your sad memories, so that, you know, I promise I'll bring this tape to the end of the world and then I'll bury it. And then all of your sad memories will go, right? If those of you who are clever enough, you recognize that this is sort of a similar motif in 2046, and by extension In the Mood for Love as well. You know, you go to a mountain, you find a tree, you find a hole, you speak to the hole, and then you put some mud on it and buries the secret. Similar sort of thing.
离开的时候天开始亮，台北现在应该是晚上。不知道辽宁街的夜市开了没有？在台湾老人邓小平是在昨天晚上9点03分病逝在北京303医院享年93岁。中共中央电视台早今天凌晨才发布邓小平的死讯。在台湾起床的时候已经是下午，在1997年2月20日我回到地球的这一边。 我觉得自己好像犯了老，来来来，好，来，坐这儿，老师，老师，慢慢。 喺我翻香港之前，我喺台北停咗一晚，我走咗去遼寧街。嗰晚嗰度好熱鬧，我見唔到小張，我見到佢哋屋企人。我終於明白佢點可以咁開心喺出邊走嚟走去，因為起碼佢個地方可以翻轉頭。我唔知我老豆見到我嗰陣會點，到時先算。 走嗰陣，我攞咗佢一張相，因為我唔知道等到幾時先會再見到佢。但係可以好肯定，如果我想見佢嘅話，起碼我知道喺邊度可以揾到佢。
Right, and then the end credits would roll soon after this. So, the inclusion of that news report of Deng Xiaoping's death on the TV there is just the biggest temptation for us to read the film as a political allegory, right? Because why else would you put it there, right? If you think about it purely from a narrative perspective, there is almost no logical reason why that bit has to be there, right? Nobody mentions anything about his death. The TV just sort of sits there, happens to be there, playing that particular news. No context whatsoever. So with that frame of the culturalist approach, one would look at these elements and form a neatly wrapped sort of politically allegorical reading that the year 1997 itself, you know, the year 1997 itself is politically sensitive, right? It was the year of the handover, and you have two exiles from Hong Kong who don't seem to have a home, and then you have this third character from Taiwan of all places who, according to Fai, you know, Tony Leung's character, has a place where he could always return to, right? And then if you also consider the lamp, right, that was meant as a sort of commemoration, memorabilia, to celebrate their future trip, you know, going to the Iguazu Falls. That never was, right? The trip was the trip that never was, right? So if you compare that to the 1997 handover itself, you could almost argue that the handover was, you know, also like that, you know, it's a commemoration of a future that never was or never will be. I'm just going to stop right there and let your imagination run wild with that sort of interpretation. You know, that's one way of reading the film, I guess. You know, similarly, in 2046, just the title itself is almost crying out for a politically allegorical reading. The year 2046 itself, of course, the end of the 50-year unchanged promise under the equally famous one country, two systems dictum? I don't know. Which, incidentally, was come up by none other than Deng Xiaoping himself, right? But let's consider it from the other approach, right? And look at how Wong Kar-wai himself explains it in the video interview, which this would be clip 1.2, so you could refer back to 1.2. I'm not going to play this because it just takes so much time. You could refer back to clip 1.2 that I uploaded on Moodle. He actually acknowledges, right? Wong Kar-wai acknowledges that 2046 is very clearly the last year of that 50-year unchanged promise. But then he quickly moves away from any of the sort of political commentary, right? And then goes on to say that he thought it would be an interesting idea to use the number itself to make a film about, and I quote, promises, right? He said it's about promises. He said 2046 is a film about promises. He doesn't elaborate any more from that. So the concept of promise itself, right, is not political. And he's sort of right. I mean, the idea of the promise, I mean, of course he is right, it is his film, right? The idea of the promise threads through 2046, right? The repeated line, if you recall the repeated line, if I tell you a secret, would you come with me? It refers to a promise that one character fails to keep for another character, be it Maggie Cheung's character to Tony Leung's character in The Mood for Love, or Fei Wong's character to his to her Japanese boyfriend, played by superstar Kimura Takuya in Japanese superstar Kimura Takuya in 2046, and so on and so on. Right, it works on that level, right, as a purely sort of love story and nothing more. Other tidbits of the making of the 2046 film from that interview clip, Wong Kar-wai mentions the fact that it was meant to be three different short stories combined into one film, a la Chungking Express style, right? For those of you who have seen or who are aware of Chungking Express. Chungking Express, of course, is also a film that joins two instead of three, two separate stories together. It was originally three, but then the third story became Fallen Angels in 1995, which was kind of why I said it wasn't worth considering. That's sort of a bad way to say this, but anyway, you know what I mean. Perhaps the most significant info is that 2046 and In the Mood for Love were originally two entirely separate films, right? 2046 was not meant to be a sequel at all. But then one day during the filming of In the Mood for Love, when Wong Kar-wai, he claimed, he looked at the hotel room set, right, in the Mood for Love, the set of In the Mood for Love, he looked at the door, and then he claimed that the room number on the door looked like 2046, without the number actually being 2046. Because I believe his exact words were 30 something. So I don't know how that could work. Like, how can you mistook 30 something to see 2046 out of that? I don't know. Maybe some sort of visual Freudian slip, right? But he saw it that way. So he made a joke, or so he claimed, right? He suggested it to the crew. He was like, why don't we change the room number in the Mood for Love, right, to room 2046? And then the idea stuck, right? And the rest was, as they say, history. So 2046 initially was a separate project, but then it became the sequel to In the Mood for Love. Finally, the one thing you should probably know about 2046 is that it was like Ashes of Time 2.0, in that Wong had taken a very long time to not finish the film. In fact, when the film was scheduled to be screened at Cannes Film Festival that year, it was not even finished. There were none of the CGI sequences, so none of what you saw on that sort of sci-fi train coming back from this place called 2046 with all those androids and all of that in the version that we all see, right? All of that was not there in the version that was screened at Cannes. So just imagine how different that would have looked like. I mean, I can't really imagine. It's quite a large portion of the film, right? After all, so at that time it was predicted that Wong's career would go downhill because now it wasn't just investors in Hong Kong, like that time with Ashes of Time. You know, this time it was people in Cannes getting a taste of how tardy Wong Kar-wai could get, who even had the nerve to present a massively unfinished film to be screened. But it never quite happened that way, right? In fact, after this, even with the failed attempt to start that project, you know, Lady from Shanghai with Nicole Kidman and with his next film, My Blueberry Nights, his first and only foray into Hollywood so far. Quite possibly his worst film, which we might talk about a bit later on if we have time. And that is objectively speaking, by the way, quite possibly his worst film. But not even that, right? Not even all of that seemed to have hurt his reputation as one of the world's greatest living filmmakers. So now you know the two sides of Wong Kar-wai. On the one hand, he is no doubt a great filmmaker. On the other hand, he is also a profligate filmmaker. No, I didn't know what this word meant either when I wrote this the first version of this lecture two years ago. But the OED, Oxford English Dictionary, defines this word as recklessly extravagant or wasteful in the use of resources. So a word that seems very specifically designed to describe Wong Kar-wai and the Wong Kar-wai only. Because we are running a bit behind schedules, I'm sorry, I can't give you a break. I'll just move on. You don't need me to tell you to go to the toilet if you need to go to the toilet, right? But I can't because I have a lecture to deliver. It's not like I need to go. Maybe stop drinking the tea. Anyway, the next part of the lecture, Wong Kar-wai as an author, we'll look at. Wong Kar-wai is not just a great filmmaker, he's also an auteur. So auteur was a term that was mentioned in passing during the past few weeks. So some of you may already be familiar with this concept, but allow me to brush up on your understanding of it a little bit. It is a French word meaning author, as in the author of a novel. Right. First used by writers of film criticism since the late 40s in France, people such as André Bazin, who some of you may be familiar with if you study film, the ontology of photographic image and all that, and Alexandre Astuc, using also the concept called la caméra stylo, right, French for the camera pen, to further that sort of director book author analogy. Right. The director who uses a pen to write his book. The idea is that the director, like the author of a novel, has the sole control of how a film looks and feels. Right. These people, along with contributors to Cahiers du Cinéma, who would later become filmmakers themselves, would constitute a movement known as the French New Wave, a period where these French writers come filmmakers challenged the very idea of what was assumed to be conventional filmmaking. They were almost like rebellious for rebellious sake. So if the Hollywood tradition has a habit of doing something, we'll just do the exact opposite, right? Just to see how it looks, right? Just to see whether it works. It doesn't work, but we just put it there anyway, right? So influenced by the French New Wave, not to mention some of his Wong's camera movement or the rhythm of his editing or the overlook, the overlook, all that sort of thing, sometimes resemble a Godard film. Wong Kar-wai can be seen as a sort of influenced by the French New Wave that way. Jean-Luc Godard is, of course, one of the most famous filmmakers coming out of the French New Wave. Now, the auteur theory certainly isn't foolproof. Like my mantra, there is no right or wrong. It's like, I don't know how many times I've repeated that already. But let's flip that script, right? What if we think of this whole theory as wrong? Right, so there is wrong. You may argue, what about the scriptwriters who are the actual writers of the film, right? Because most of the time, the scriptwriters aren't the same people as the directors, right? And also, what about the actors? The very people that you see, right, coming first, right, visually, is usually the very first thing that you can see. What about their influence? Right. What about the set designers? What about the music composers? And so on and so forth. What about the artistic input from all of them? Right. Shall we all, should they be dismissed then? So that's like the opposite, the flip side of his argument, right? But let's come back and, you know, come back to the original side of this debate and just simply buy into the idea of the auteur and just look at these images, right? You know, these different films from the same director, and hopefully you know who this director is. Who is this director? I'm sure you all know who this is, right? And what about this one, right? You can tell just by the way he frames his trademark squared on sort of almost symmetrical shots with a saturated color palette that this is no doubt Wes Anderson, right? The idea is that if you know the director's style and then you see his or her next film without knowing that person is the director, you can still tell that you know who the director is, right? This is the mark of a true auteur. What about this one? Right, this one may be a bit hard to tell. Yeah, white director's name in the chat, Gina. Thanks. This one might be a bit hard to tell, you know, because as you can see, there doesn't seem to be like a common aesthetic theme to like all these pictures. And I deliberately picked the less popular films by the director. Yes, very good. Obviously a fan then, I think. He has a particular way of, you know, storytelling, and he always likes to put a twist towards the end, and he always likes to, you know, do this sort of parallel editing between two different scenes, often happening at different times, right? But with a similar sort of urgency, right? That sort of parallel editing. Sort of like Wong Kar-wai himself, he's also clearly interested in time, you know, Christopher Nolan. So incidentally, if you imagine Wong Kar-wai directing Tenet, you know, how much better that mediocre film would be, or, you know, Christopher Nolan directing In the Mood for Love or 2046, you know, how interesting that can be. Yeah. But imagination then, I guess. What about Wong Kar-wai himself as an auteur? Right and wrong here. What about the first director they asked you to name? Of course, they all know who that is, hopefully. I mean, otherwise, all of our efforts have gone to waste, right? Do you know what I mean? So what about Wong Kar-wai, right? So he has both types of auteurist qualities, right? The style elements that you can visually see, kind of like Wes Anderson, as well as the more subtle sort of hidden elements such as, you know, storytelling methods or, you know, editing techniques that are sort of less visibly, obvious. So to further illustrate Wong Kar-wai's interest in time, which is, you know, very much one of his auteurist traits, let's look at a couple more films from this time. I've chosen Chungking Express and the expiry dates of canned pineapples. Right, so let's see this clip.
Son of a poke.
But mom,
I'm going. You're going to get me.
沒有,今天全民 call你喔
哦,麻煩 我們分手的那一天是愚人節 所以我一直當他是開玩笑 我願意讓他這個玩笑維持一個月 從分手的那一天開始 我每天都買一罐5月1號到期的鳳梨罐頭 因為鳳梨是阿妹最愛吃的東西 而5月1號是我生日 我告訴我自己 当我买满30罐的时候 他如果还不回来 这段感情就会过期
Right, and then later on.
Hello, 就是你这种人啊贪心蒙搞的。
喂你知不知道钱公布来洗多少心机啊
啊又要种又要拆又要切你说不要就不要啊你有没有两个罐头感受啊
阿生我是打工的咋我是卖嘢的你叫我想罐头感受你有没有想我的感受啊我又要担又要抬还要托啊。我告诉你罐头永远不会过期啦我懒得不用做啊。咁即系过期罐头啊嘛，嗱，一箱送俾你，收你钱嘅。
不知道从什么时候开始，在每一个东西上面都有一个日子。秋刀鱼会过期，肉酱也会过期，连保鲜纸都会过期。我开始怀疑，在这个世界上还有什么东西是不会过期的。
话说，老师你已经看到了。
Right, so everything has an expiry date, right? So you could argue that, you know, this is just a guy who's like a super romantic, right? He doesn't want to accept the fact that his girlfriend breaks up with him, so he's sort of made a little sort of game and buying all those canned pineapples that were expired before May the 1st, right?It's just sort of a romantic gesture, right? But then another way to look at it is obviously the cultural reading. July 1st, 1997, obviously itself is like an expiry date, right? So is 30th of June 2046, right? You know, 50-year unchanged promise and all that. So, you know, with that in mind, you can sort of explain away how the canned pineapples are. In fact, a commentary on the state of Hong Kong, or, you know, how Hong Kong is basically like the pineapples, which does sound kind of interesting, but I digress. Here we just focus on Wong Kar-wai's preoccupation with time. So it's sort of interesting, you know, with the expiry date of the pineapples and stuff. Now, next up in the list of Wong Kar-wai's auteurist trait is... His trademark shaky, jerky camera movement done by a technique called step printing, right? Which is a kind of like how you would mess around with the frame rates if you think about it in terms of digital production. But obviously step printing is a film thing because you can only print on film and not digital because there's nothing to print in digital. But if you slow down the frame rates when you work with digital, you should probably be able to get similar results. It looks something like this. So actually, instead of clip 7, I'm going to play you clip 13, which is essentially the same clip but a bit shorter. It's the same guy with the pineapples again from Chongqing Express. Let's see. Right, this isn't step printing, by the way. I'll tell you when it starts. You know, you can just tell. Right, there. I hope you have paid attention to what he said in the dialogue because it will come up later, very interestingly, later on in the lecture. It'll come in handy. Clip 8 from As Tears Go By. It's the typical gangster film, right? It's just a fight scene, but it's shot with this technique called step printing. Sorry for any animal lovers there. No animals were harmed in the making of this film, I presume. So you see, it interchanges between like normal, you know, footage at normal speeds and also footage edited with the step printing technique. Yeah, I think that's enough. You know, people like Abbas, like Akbar Abbas, would comment on it and say that this demonstrates a sort of postmodern, the postmodern nature in Hong Kong, like how it's all fragmented because like these frames are all fragmented, right? The fragmented nature of the postmodern existence, which was something that was sort of mentioned in last week's lecture, right? So that's the sort of a culturalist approach. But here I'm just looking at it as an interesting technique, right? It certainly adds something new to, you know, what would otherwise be a conventional sort of fight scene, but it adds that sort of Wong Kar-wai flavor to it. Right. Incidentally, one of those was done by Andrew Lau, the co-director of Infernal Affairs from last week, when the other one was done by Christopher Doyle, the Chungking Express one. Right. So here you see two different cinematographers yielding similar results. Right. So it does sort of reaffirm the concept of the auteur, right, having that ultimate control, that ultimate say over his style. Next up is Wong Kar-wai's treatment to the foreground background split. Conventionally, you want to put your subject in the foreground, right, and then the background is blurred, right? Isn't that how you normally take a photo on your phone, right? You know, even phones nowadays have this, you know, portrait mode just to emulate that sort of shallow depth of field effect, accentuating the foreground, right? But Wong Kar-wai likes to do the opposite. Right? He often likes to put things, the most important thing, in like the backest of backgrounds, right? And while the foreground is like obscured by some large objects out of focus. Let's just take a look at this very famous example of the rice cooker scene from In the Mood for Love and see just how many times the foreground is being obscured by, you know, things. So clip 9. Right, you see the sort of the curtain there. Again, some curtains, the lamp shade. Again, this, I don't know what this is. The hallway itself, sort of occupying most of the foreground. Like, the majority of the frame is being obscured here, right? Right, even here, I mean, look at it. The main subject, you would argue, is Maggie Cheung's character herself, but she's sitting on the furthest back in this framing. Whereas, you know, you have these people, you know, experiencing the rice cooker for the first time, and then you have these lamps sort of occupying the foreground. So it's a very Wong Kar-wai sort of thing. I'm also including another clip from Happy Together, but I don't think we have enough time to play it. So if you're interested, you could go on Moodle and just check out clip 10. You see another example of the foreground obscuring sort of technique. It's essentially just this shot, right? This is the reflection, seeing Chang Chen's character in Happy Together. There are a lot of other things that constitute the Wong Kar-wai style, the non-linear narrative structure. Not quite Tenet style non-linear narrative structure, but still non-linear nonetheless, right? For instance, 2046, you see there is a scene with Tony Leung and Gong Li near the beginning of the film. You know, they talk about things, but if things are to be presented in the chronological order, that scene should probably be towards the end and not the start. So, you know, there, right away, you see an example of non-linear narrative structure. Episodic storytelling. The original plan for 2046 was similar to Chungking Express, with two or three completely different stories joined together. And you could definitely say that's episode. Even as it is now, you could say that the episode of Chow and Bai Ling is one episode, and, you know, Chow and Fei Wong's character is another episode. It's like it's so episodic, you can separate different parts of the story. That is also very Wong Kar-wai. His taste in music or his use of the music, something that I will come back to in a bit. The theme of love, definitely. I mean, Wong Kar-wai doesn't really seem to make any other type of films except ones that surround the topic of love, or more precisely, unfulfilled love. Not unrequited love, right? Because unrequited love is when the love is one-directional, unidirectional, if you will. The love doesn't get reciprocated. So Bai Ling's love towards Chow in 2046 is definitely unrequited, but everything else is what I would describe as unfulfilled. Because very often the two people you see both seem to love each other, but then because of one thing or another, they can never get back together. Right? The love story between Fei Wong's character and Kimura Takuya's characters, it almost ended up being unfulfilled, right? If not for the meddling of Chow, if you remember, and sort of playing this not-so-secret Santa to help them get back together. Incidentally, very interestingly, Fei Wong's storyline in Chungking Express also gets a happy ending. So that love is also sort of fulfilled in the end, which is a rare thing in Wong Kar-wai, because usually it just ends in not so much a tragedy, but it's just a sort of melancholic feel to it. Right? It's definitely something that's very prominently featured in The Mood for Love, the better film. Right. Lastly is Love of Literature, which we will touch on the next slide. In case you haven't noticed, I was going for this particular aesthetic of In the Mood for Love, white on red, so on literature, right, the relationship between his films and literature, very often there aren't they aren't direct adaptations as it were, like the films are. Even Ashes of Time, right, if you recall, which was sort of the closest to a book adaptation as a Wong Kar-wai film could get, that wasn't even a direct adaptation, if at all. Right? The story, if you're aware of the Jin Yong novel, the story in Ashes of Time, it just becomes totally unrecognizable from the original. The same characters are there, but that's sort of about it, right? Nothing else is the same. The focus is placed in all the wrong places, narrative developments feel just sort of out of joint. Even in The Mood for Love and 2046, it was only the intertitle cards, right, which are the blank screens with the words on them. Only those words come from these novels. And the stories themselves, they bear very little, if at all, resemblances. Right? So it definitely be interesting to see how Blossoms, Shanghai, whatever it will be called, or whether it will be made at all. Or whether he'll be pulling an Ashes of Time or 2046 on us and can never finish the project, right? We never know. A word on his use of the music. Wong Kar-wai's films usually repurpose existing songs and make them feel like the film's own original music. Case in point would be California Dreamin' and the Cranberry song Dreams, which incidentally were the two songs I played before the start of today's lecture. You know those are pre-existing pop songs from very different eras, but once you've seen Chungking Express, they become like the film's original soundtrack in a way. A point, incidentally, which was also made by Tarantino himself in that little YouTube video that I didn't play, but I highly recommend you catch that. In 2046, pretty much all of the music are pre-existing. Some of them are from other films. Some of them are just popular songs for different contexts, as you can see on the slide there. Perhaps the best example of a Wong Kar-wai repurposing of a pre-existing music is this piece called Yumeji's Theme. It was the original music composed for a 1991 Japanese film called Yumeji, hence Yumeji's Theme. But I don't think anybody would hear it now and not think that it's that tune from In the Mood for Love, right? So in case you don't know what that is, let me just search for it. This one, right? You wouldn't know that this music was from a Japanese film somewhere, some time ago. You just recognize it as that tune from In the Mood for Love, that Wong Kar-wai tune, right? You know what I mean? Meanwhile, this is also part of the reason why I think My Blueberry Nights is only foray into Hollywood was or is his worst film. Right. The next auteurist trait that I'll point out is his self-referentiality. So here he's sort of overdone. He has overdone the self-referencing here. And you know what I mean when I play this clip. Right? So you'll recognize the Umeji theme music, right? And if you still have that music in your head, and then you see this clip.
Can I take a look?
Sure. Come round.
This is My Blueberry Nights, Wong Kar-wai's 2007 film, by the way. I think you get the idea, right? So it's a very different rendition of Umeji's theme. So a repurposing of an already repurposed piece of music because it came from a 1991 Japanese film. But that's just the start of it, right? The whole film, My Blueberry Nights, it just feels like a Wong Kar-wai's greatest hits album, but almost like a greatest hits performed by a tribute band. Instead of the real band, if you know what I mean. So you could look at My Blueberry Nights as a sort of a breakdown of the auteur theory, right? Sort of understanding it as a greatest hits album sort of thing that failed, right? So it's a fail or a failure of the auteur theory in a way. I don't know. So as I was saying, right, self-referentiality is what Wong Kar-wai often does. So you just saw one of the examples there. He repurposed one of his already repurposed music, right? The use of Umeji's theme in My Blueberry Nights. Perhaps a bad example of this, but more easily understandable example would be something like this. You know, the famous back of a taxi shot. This is from In the Mood for Love, obviously. And then this is from Happy Together. You see a similar framing. You see Tony Leung there. This is from 2046. You should have seen the film by now, so you would immediately recognize this. And then lastly, Tony Leung is all left alone, you know, because he can't love anymore, you know, that sort of thing. So he's all alone. So you see how, like, all these frames are, you know, they all look similar, right? They have a similar sort of arrangement. So, you know, in this way, he's sort of self-referring to himself, right? It's a self-reflexivity kind of thing, which is one of his trademarks, you could argue. So I hope you still remember that one clip from the Chungking Express clip that I showed you with the pineapples guy. He says, every day you rub shoulders with strangers who may become friends one day. You remember that, and hopefully you still remember that, and then you watch this clip. This is from Fallen Angels.
I'm still a boy. 我是一个很开朗的人，从小我就很喜欢讲话。但是自从五岁那一年，我吃了一罐过期的凤梨罐头之后呢，我就没有再讲过话了。妈的，因为这样子，所以我朋友很少，想找份工作做呢，也就变成很难。
Right, so you see, see how interesting that was, right? He's the same guy, right?But not quite the same guy, obviously, because it's a different film, right? Given Fallen Angels was, as I said, it was meant to be the third story on top of the two that were already in Chungking Express. It's sort of understandable why Wong Kar-wai played this sort of trick, referencing his earlier film, right? But, these two Herchiwus, right, the same guy, but not quite the same guy, bring us very neatly to the final part. Hopefully we still have time to cover this, right? We have 15 minutes left. This final part of today's lecture, where I present to you my third approach. A time travel way to understand cinema, right? To have a easier understanding. I would just to explain briefly what is time travel, right? There are two ways to look at time, or roughly two ways of time. There are multiple ways, but roughly there are two. One is a deterministic way of looking at time, where the past cannot be changed and the future cannot be changed. Everything is said, and you go through fate or whatever. So in that, under that sort of belief, there is only one universe, right? You can't change anything. You're only following fate, following whatever, you know, higher forces make you go through, like be it God or whatever. The other way to understand time, right, which is a more interesting way to look at it, is that past or future, everything can be changed. And the way to change that, the way to change time, to change the past, is by thinking in terms of the multiverse, right? I don't know whether you have heard of the multiverse theory. So that is to think of the world as having multiple universes, right? Parallel universes. So instead of just one universe, we have multiple versions of the reality, so that when you go back to the past and change something, reality splits, right? It splits between, it splits into two realities, right? And in cinema, luckily, we have a very, very sort of visual manifestation of this happening. So I'll show you this. This is a film called Sliding Doors. And just watch it. Right, so you see how there are two Gwyneth Paltrows here, right? Gwyneth Paltrow plays, I mean, it's not a particularly nice film, but it just provides us with a nice sort of visual, cue to understand this sort of split reality thing, right? You see, so the story goes, Gwyneth Paltrow plays this woman who gets fired at work. So, you know, she goes to the tube and she catches the tube train. For some reason, Gwyneth Paltrow, being American, she's playing a Brit here. That she goes to catch the train to go back home, essentially, because she's so sad, and she gets fired, and she goes back home. But then she was, as you could see from that clip, right? She was being stopped briefly by that little girl playing with the doll, right? So she couldn't get to the train in time to catch that train. So one version of reality is Helen, played by Gwyneth Paltrow. Helen can't get on the train. And then the other version is the little girl didn't stop Helen from going down the stairs, so Helen gets on the train. So the difference in that sort of slight bit of difference. Makes a very drastic difference in the two different realities. So in one reality where she catches the train, she gets home early to catch her boyfriend cheating on her, basically catches him in the act, right? She sees him with another woman, sort of thing. Whereas the Helen who doesn't catch the train, she gets home slightly late, giving time for that other woman to leave the premises, so she can't see, right, her boyfriend cheating on her. So you see, the film would then split into two realities. It sort of plays on the idea of parallel editing to the extreme, kind of. On the one hand, you see Helen living new life, having broken up with this cheating boyfriend, whereas in the other timeline, Helen, unaware of her boyfriend's infidelity, just keeps on living with him and being miserable without really understanding why she's being miserable. So you have two parallel sort of timelines, intercutting with one another, sort of parallel editing at his most extreme kind of thing. So I mean, it's sort of easily understandable, right? So if you you could have similar things where you could catch the MTR train. You have a version of you who just about catches the train, so you get on the train and then you arrive at the destination earlier. But there's another version of you who doesn't get on the train, so the reality splits. You could say this is similar here because you see two versions of her Ji Wu's here. One is in Chungking Express, who is a cop, number 223, and in Fallen Angels, he's a prisoner, also number 223, also have a sort of a peculiar relationship with canned pineapples. You see, like you could sort of understand them as sort of two different realities, right? Sort of two parallel universes. You can sort of use similar ways to understand the new Suli Jin and the old Suli Jin. They're sort of the same person, but then they're not the same person. Yeah, I don't know whether you get it. Here you have the Jeffrey Lau film, if you still remember, the comedic rendition of the, or pretty much the same film. Like, these are pretty much the same film, but you have the comedic rendition, and then you have Wong Kar-wai's own sort of artistic rendition of the same film. Again, it's sort of like two separate, different parallel realities. And even the film, it's Ashes of Time itself, it had a redux version. I believe the story was like the original print was damaged or something, and Wong Kar-wai needed to remaster the original print from 1994, and he invited Yo-Yo Ma to play the music as well. Incidentally, I really like that music as well. I wish I had the chance to play that music during the lecture, but maybe some other time. So two different versions of the very same film, right? I don't think you can catch the 1994 version anymore. I really wish I could. Like, I really wish I could catch the original version of the music, really. Here, this makes my sort of idea of the time travel, the parallel universe thing, really, really apparent, right? You have a universe, which is our universe. We don't get the lady from Shanghai, which is why I put the crying emoji there, because I really would love to see that film. Nicole Kidman and all that. Whereas if you imagine it, maybe if Wong Kar-wai has made the right connections, maybe Nicole Kidman had the right sort of scheduling, maybe they could really work together and make The Lady from Shanghai. Maybe there is an alternative universe somewhere where there really is a lady from Shanghai. And also, if you recall, I made that joke about Wong Kar-wai directing Tenet and Christopher Nolan directing 2046. That could happen. You don't know. Also, the film The Grand Master. This actually happens in reality, so you don't have to like be a crazy guy like me to sort of come up with these sort of fanciful like imaginations. This actually happens in reality, right? You have the U.S. version of The Grand Master, which is Wong Kar-wai's 2013 film. and you have a totally different cut, the original cut that was released in China and the rest of Asia, I believe. And then when it was brought to the US, Harvey Weinstein, of all people, you know, he sort of believed, our audience wouldn't love this sort of cut. You know, I would cut it some other way. So it sort of ruins the film. But I mean, I don't want to admit it, but I kind of like the US version more than the original China version. But you get two versions of the same film, which are kind of very different. If you have seen these two versions, you'll understand how it's sort of different, sort of like two different films instantly. Furthermore, you remember I mentioned the version of 2046, the massively unfinished version of 2046 screened at Cannes, and the version we all saw, right, you know, on Moodle, or maybe before, or the original ideas for 2046, which, you know, if you recall, Wong Kar-wai's original plan was to make like three shorter separate stories to sort of combine them together, kind of like Chungking Express. And then, you know, the room number thing happened, and so 2046 was then associated within The Mood for Love. So you could understand like all these sort of subtle differences in terms of like parallel universe that can coexist with one another. That's my main point. You could have these parallel universes, and the point of having these parallel universes, these sort of almost antagonistic concepts or realities, they can coexist with one another, kind of like this one. You know, you can watch 2046 without having seen In the Mood for Love, or you can watch 2046 after having seen In the Mood for Love. Like I said, always, there's no right or wrong way of watching a film. So whether you have seen episode one before going to episode two, nobody's going to tell you it's wrong, right? Even Wong Kar-wai himself advocates having seen 2046 first before In the Mood for Love. So you see, you know, different ways. Obviously, you can't have both experiences together. So that's kind of a sticky point in my sort of theories, because you can't turn back time, essentially. So if you have seen In the Mood for Love first, you can't have that sort of fresh experience anymore going into 2046. Whereas those people who haven't seen In the Mood for Love, you guys are the lucky ones, because you don't. I mean, after this lecture, I've ruined the experience for you, because you know Tony Leung and Maggie Cheung's sort of relationship, the old Sulijun and all that. So I've sort of half ruined the fresh experience for you. But you know what I mean. If you haven't seen In the Mood for Love, you still have that sort of innocence in a way going into 2046. Whereas if you have seen In the Mood for Love first before 2046, you can never get back that innocence, because you can't turn back time. Right. Now here's the big one. I think I'm sorry it took me like nearly 2 hours to get to this big one, right? What I mean by the third approach, by considering things, you know, keep on repeating, there is no right or wrong, or, you know, understanding it in terms of like parallel universes that can coexist with one another, this would be the big one. Instead of pitting two opposing or antagonistic, as I said, approaches to reading a film, why not combine them together, right, as a sort of you know, to reconcile the two, right? You have the culturalist approach to read the film and the aesthetic, right? Why not combine both and create something that's your own, right? So that's kind of what I meant by understanding it in the third approach. And if you recall, back in the beginning of the lecture, I, you know, highlighted multiple worlds in the Apadurai quote, multiple worlds. When I look at the phrase, it reminds me of parallel universes, right? Of course, Apadurai himself never meant it as multiple universes, but who is to say that I'm wrong when I read the Apadurai and I think of parallel universes and like a sort of an attempt to reconcile apparently opposing ways of thinking, right? And isn't that the whole point of globalization, right? You know, globalization, kind of, you know, the whole world as one, and, you know, all that sort of thing. You know, even heterogenization, homogenization, all of that is to reconcile, you know, different people. So I don't know, it's just sort of my way to look at things, really, not just films, but looking at things. So this is the last slide I have. I mean, if you're interested in linking, you know, time travel with actual Hong Kong films that have time travel in it, because 2046 doesn't have time travel. It's just my sort of, you know, fanciful, fantastical way of imagining things that can forge that, you know, sort of relationship between 2046 and time travel. These films, right, are definitely films that feature time travel narratives. Second time around, by Jeffrey Lau of all people. So you see that it's not a Mo Lei Tao film. Yeah, I have to add, it's got no Mo Lei Tao elements. It's like a it's sort of a romance story, kind of. Yi Kin Chan's character just sort of go back in time to save Cecilia Cheung's character. Very romantic, all that. And then you have Stephen Chow's Back to Shanghai. It's sort of like a lazy narrative device, to be honest. The sort of going back in time thing doesn't really matter, although it does matter to the in the climax, right? Because he realizes that he was that historical figure that he read earlier in the film. So that kind of makes a sort of cause and effect relationship kind of, you know, significant. Too many ways to be number one, right? Because the film was released in 1997, most people would look at this film as, oh, it's a, you know, it's a political allegory of the handover experience, right? You have identity crisis. It's kind of like how this small-time gang member trying to become number one. It's sort of like how Hong Kong people navigate their identities, whatever. You know me, I mean, I don't want to say I don't like that sort of reading, but it's, I mean, come on, it's a fun time travel sort of story. Kind of like Sliding Doors, which incidentally is, you could say they all took inspiration from Krzysztof Kieślowski's, what's the name of the film? I think Gina knows, right? is it Blind Chance?
Yeah, Double Life of Veronique.
That is one, but no, I'm thinking of the one with the train, right? You see the young guy joining the Communist Party, and then you have another reality where the young guy doesn't join in the Communist Party and sort of opposing the. I think it's called Blind Chance, but yeah, it's a Kieślowski film, so they all draw influence from that film, in case you're wondering. But I know.
Yeah, it is Blind Chance.
Oh, excellent. Decalogue, yeah, Decalogue also has that sort of thing. I mean, of course, Kieślowski is also kind of like, you know, Wong Kar-wai and Christopher Nolan as well. He sort of has a preoccupation with time as well. But anyway, I'm sort of moving too far away from 9001, but it's all just a chit-chat on film. So I don't know, maybe some of you are interested in that sort of thing. Anyway, this is the end of my lecture. So any questions or comments? If not, then I guess we'll all see you at the tutorials next week.